Good evening, everyone. My name is Paul O'Neill, and on behalf of Kingston's Buried Treasures, I'd like to welcome everyone to tonight's presentation in our monthly series. Tonight, we're going to do something a little bit different. We have spent the past 3 years focusing on the individuals and at times places that have played such a prominent role in our history. But tonight, we're going to talk about an object. We're going to talk about a sign, actually, a very special sign. And that sign is very special for a number of reasons. First, the sign represents perhaps our most prominent of the of our early families, the DeWitt family. The sign, and there's a beautiful picture of it up here, if you can see, was the sign for the DeWitt Inn, the Crocodile Inn at DeWitt Mill. And the DeWitt Mill was originally constructed by Charles DeWitt, who is without question one of the most important people, certainly from our area during the Revolutionary era. He was second only to George Clinton in prominence during that time. So the sign really is a representation of this incredibly important family. Secondly, it's a great story. It really is just a great story. You know, we all love history, and that's why we're here. But I don't think I'm going very far out on a limb to say we would all love to hit the lottery. We'd all love to find a buried treasure. Well, this sign literally was a buried treasure, and the story of how it came to be found and what happened after that is just fascinating. And there are winners in this story, and there are losers in this story. Some people, I'm sure, were kicking their heels in delight, and some were shedding a tear or two. But I think when you hear the story, whatever side you take, you're going to think it's one of the most fascinating stories around. And we're very fortunate tonight to have with us, as our presenter, someone who's had a very, very personal relationship with this sign. And she is in a very special position to be able to tell this tale. Gail Whistance, and I'm going to let her tell you what her relationship is with this. But Gail spent the past several years going around and talking about this sign and the circumstances surrounding it, and a little bit about the DeWitt Mill and Charles DeWitt. And she has done an incredible job in bringing back an appreciation for the DeWitt family and Charles DeWitt. It's sad that he has been relegated somewhat to the dustbin here because he was so important, such an important figure, not only in our local history, but in the history of New York State and really in the history of the United States. So it is with great pleasure that I welcome our featured speaker tonight, Gail Whistance.
Thank you, Paul, for inviting me here, and I'm going to be standing right between these two microphones, so if I veer off one way or the other, he's going to give me the signal. I hope you can all hear me. I tend to have a soft voice, so I'm going to make a point of speaking out. I feel very honored to be here as part of the Kingston Buried Treasures series. Always had an interest in local history. I'm actually originally from Illinois, Northern Illinois, which has about 200 years less of European colonial history than we do here. The Europeans didn't start settling Northern Illinois until the 1830s. So by that time, Kingston was, you know, an old place. Today I'm going to talk about a story of the Crocodile Inn, and it ties into the history of Kingston, the history of Ulster County, the state, and even the country. As Paul pointed out, the connection with Charles DeWitt is an important one. And I put this presentation together back in 2010 when Wally Cook, who was president of the Hurley Heritage Society at the time, was listening to my talking about this sign and all the things that happened around it. And so, you know, you really should talk to us about that. That's a lecture. Will you give us a lecture? And so that's how it got. So I owe this to Wally. I guess I had done the research, but didn't put it into a presentation until Wally talked me into it. So he kind of jostled me out of my sleepy retirement years into doing this. I'm glad he did. The reason I got involved in this story is because of a phone call that Bruce and I, my husband Bruce and I, received from his dad, Jack Whistance. So it's my father-in-law, Jack. He calls us up, very excited. he has found this amazing historical artifact. It's a wonderful piece of folk art in original condition, never been touched, retouched. It was the original tavern sign from the Crocodile Inn. And so the story, and what's really interesting about that is that's only about a mile from where we live. So it was even more exciting to us because we'd gone past that historical marker and not paid too much attention to it at the foot of our road. But here it was, the sign that actually hung there. So the story, as Paul has said, involves not only the sign itself, which is a story, but the an important Dutch family that and the mill that they ran there. All right. So now let's see if I can do this. Am I going to do it right? Is that good? Okay. The story involves, as I said, a sign and the inn where it stood. If you've ever been at the foot of DeWitt Mills Road where it meets Route 32, there's actually two historical markers there, one by the wall and one across the road from it. And you probably, many of you recognize this sign. But after we got that call from Jack, I thought, I better take a closer look at that sign. And it says this is where Crocodile Inn opened around 1800. Opened by Garret, DeWitt. And so the inn is mentioned on the one marker, and then across the road is the marker for the DeWitt's Mill itself, which was across the road. And when I started researching this, when Jack was, you know, interested in buying it, because he said it was going to go up for auction, and Jay Werbalowski's auction in the near future, I looked into it a little bit, and the sign itself is mentioned in two separate publications with a description of what was on it. One was the Old Ulster magazine, and the other is Helen Wilkinson Reynolds' book on old Dutch stone houses. So there were two publications that actually describe the sign, and so that it really gives it good provenance from a antique collector's point of view. So here we are. So Jack is interested in bidding on this sign, and I get the job of researching it, which I really enjoyed. Now I want to first let you envision what the place looked like, where the sign stood. This is a picture from the Reynolds book, which is actually a very well-respected book. It was it's called Dutch Houses in the Hudson Valley Before 1776. This picture, and what was really good about this, the research done for this book, is that Helen herself went around the Hudson Valley and physically took pictures, visited these houses, and many of the ones she documented don't even exist anymore. So it's a very important book that she produced there and is used heavily by researchers. And it's the only picture, it's the earliest picture I found. I thought it was the earliest picture at the time anyway, and the only picture of this house before it was replaced by the house that you see there today. This picture of the house was taken in 1925, so back when the inn was opened in 1800, it looked different than this. There wouldn't have been the gable in front or the porch. And you can see, if you look closely at the picture, there's an addition, a stone addition, past that kitchen door on the side. The area past that is actually a new stone addition. And that might have been added to make it larger for the inn in 1800. But the large dormer and the front porch would have been late 1800s, would have been added then. The most notable resident of this house was Colonel Charles DeWitt. His father built it in, I think it was 1736, I believe it is. Did I say? Yeah, 1736. And so this is where Colonel Charles DeWitt grew up. And he was father of Garret DeWitt, who opened the inn in 1800. So now I want you to look at this picture closely. There, if you look closely at the wall in front of the house, right in the middle, is a millstone built into the wall. So, and that's still there today, so just keep that image in mind. And in these following pictures, you'll see that same millstone there, and it still is there today. Now, I thought that the picture I found in Reynolds' book was the only picture that existed of the inn, but I was very happy to have a DeWitt family member listening to this lecture when I gave it at the Hurley Heritage Society. Her name was Marilyn Wright. She lived in Tilson. And she said, well, I have pictures of that house. My mother grew up in that house. And I thought, you do? So that was fantastic. So that was a very happy outcome. And she, and then after the presentation, I went to visit her and got these images from her. So this one I'm estimating is around 1900. Great picture showing the oxen in front. But it's the same, the gable is there already. And you can see the millstone built into the wall. And Marilyn said she remembers her mother telling her that there was a big front room in the house, and she can remember mothers telling stories about pushing the furniture to the walls in that room and having dances at the house. And I can almost hear the fiddle playing, can't you? And boot stomping. She gave me a second picture. This one, I think, is probably 1920s. There's a bicycle on the front porch. The trellis is gone. The stone is still there to orient yourself. So then a few summers ago, when I first gave this presentation, I decided to try to take a picture from the same angle that Reynolds had. And it's interesting. That's not the next picture. I'm not sure what happened there. I don't think so. There should be another picture after that of a current picture of the house. Well, you'll have to just, if you've ever been to the foot of DeWitt Mills Road, there's a reddish house there, and that curved stone wall is still there on the corner, and the that millstone is still built into the wall. Sorry, I don't have that picture. I wanted to point out on that picture that I had to stand in a patch of poison ivy to get the exact angle. So I ran home and washed up after that. But right now there's a 1933 frame house built on that same foundation. And it's kind of a reddish color. Okay, so now here's the artifact that Jack was so excited about. Crocodile Inn sign. Why is it so special, and why was Jack so excited, and why was he, you know, thinking, you know, I'm willing to really bid this one up? He said the tavern signs are extremely rare in the first place. They think only about 50,000 tavern signs were produced total, you know, through the history, and a fraction of them have survived. They were made out of wood, they were exposed to the elements, and they were either repainted or thrown away, you know, away, put a new one up. It wasn't really thought to keep them at the time. So very few have survived over the years. That figure, 50,000, is estimated from 1750 to 1850. About 50,000 were produced. There are museums that feature tavern signs. There's the Connecticut Historical Society in Hartford has a very nice collection of them. Shelburne Museum in Vermont and Old Sturbridge Village in Massachusetts have good collections of signs. They're valued by the museums because they really represent a window into history. They would have been part of the landscape that people saw as they traveled from place to place, or as they came, you know, tired at the end of the day, ready to stay somewhere, that they would see that sign. So it really gives us a very nice you know, picture into that world. And interestingly, the Massachusetts required, by law, it was required, you know, Massachusetts loves their laws, but they had a law requiring a tavern sign. If you had an inn, you had to have a sign. So, and to make a sign, they needed three artisans to make it. You needed a joiner, like a furniture maker, to make the frame. You needed a blacksmith to make the hardware, and a painter to paint it. So there wasn't really one person that made signs. You had to go from artisan to artisan. That what's special about this sign is that it's a unique subject, you know, crocodile. It's the only one that anybody had ever heard of that was had a crocodile as a subject. And it was in untouched condition. It had never been painted over. This is the original coat of paint. What's And it's also a beautiful piece of folk art. I mean, it's done by an untutored artist, somebody who probably had never seen a live crocodile. I mean, probably they had drawn lions before, maybe dogs, and you can see the paws are almost lion-like, you know, and it's upright on its legs. I mean, a crocodile's down low. So this person really didn't understand the anatomy of a crocodile, but it's a very charming picture nonetheless. And actually the rows of teeth kind of remind you of, you know, maybe, I don't know if crocodile teeth look like that. And the it has a rectangular frame which helps to date it. There, it's the style of sign that would have been made in the late 1700s or early 1800s. So that sort of supports the date of 1800 as the inn being open. So now the next slide, I just showed you what I'm showing you what a earlier type of sign would look like. This is more the British style of sign. So the very earliest signs from the early 1700s would have looked like this, with a frame around the outside and a sort of upright rectangular shape with the board suspended in the frame. Okay. And also the this sign is showing just visual imagery, whereas later signs had more lettering on them. Like this just has the name of the proprietor at the bottom. And our sign comes a little later. There's the additional lettering called Crocodile. All right. So now I've put together a little timeline just to orient yourself for what happened here with the sign. In 1806, approximately, Garret DeWitt, who's the son of Charles DeWitt, our famous Charles DeWitt, he opens the Crocodile Inn and he renovates his father's mill. His father had built the mill around 1750, the original mill. By 1849, that original mill was 100 years old and was rebuilt by Garrett's son, Richard DeWitt. And in the Old Ulster Magazine, 1912, and in Reynolds' book, 1925, the sign was observed at the house. It was, I think, according to Reynolds, it was up in the attic, you know, stored in the attic. And then what I found out from our DeWitt family member is that the DeWitts sold the house just before it burned. It was like late. So this is the only reason the sign survived, is that in 1928 or 29, the house was sold out of the DeWitt family. And presumably the sign was taken with them, because in 1930, the house burns, but that sign didn't. And then in 1933, a new house was built on that old foundation. And then 75 years ago, well, how many years is that? 70-something years goes by. And the sign comes up for auction in Kingston. So there's a very large gap there. We're not really sure where it was all those years, but it got saved. It was just by a miracle, really. So the way it got found was that Jay Werbalowski, our local auctioneer, was in the house of a client, and he noticed this sign on the wall. He said, it's a nice sign, and he thought maybe he could buy it. Nah, it wasn't really for sale. I like it. He was there to look at some furniture, not to look at the sign. But he noticed it. To his credit, he noticed it as something kind of special, and didn't want to sell it. Well, maybe I'll auction it for you. I might be able to get you several thousand dollars for it. It's like, if you can get me that much for it, then you can sell it. So thanks to Jay, it was taken out of that house and put up for sale. Now, the most common question I get about this sign is, why a crocodile? I mean, it's not like they were walking around Ulster County. The family history, the DeWitt family history says that, and this was recounted in Reynolds' book, said that there was a stone outcropping in the basement where they didn't bother to blast it. It was just a natural stone outcropping they left there, suggested the tail or the back of a crocodile. And then that's why they named it Crocodile Inn. And actually, I did get down to see it, and it's a bumpy rock, you know, there, and I guess if you really use your imagination. But we thought about that some more, and Jack and Bruce and I were talking about it, and then a friend of Jack's brought him a book called Tulip Mania. Apparently in the 1600s in Holland, there was a, it was like the dot-com bubble. Tulip bulbs were very precious, and they were traded and sold, and different varieties got very expensive, and it was a bubble. It did crash eventually, but this Tulip Mania book was about that craze. And in that book, and this client of Jack's brought it to him, said, look at this, because it said that in that book that the tulip bulbs were traded in the apothecaries. That's sort of a place of business where people would meet at the apothecaries and then make their trades and go home. And they'd also sit and chat for a while and maybe have some of the medicine that was there at the apothecary. And so the book was making the claim that these shops that were supposedly medicine shops were doubled as clandestine drinking establishments. And it also said as part of the decor in these places, often you have a stuffed crocodile hanging from the ceiling to sort of impart this aura of mystery and I have more knowledge than the average citizen sort of thing. And so the Dutch people would have been used to seeing a crocodile hanging from the ceiling at a place where they gathered and talked and had drinks. And so we think that might have been another reason for it being not such an unusual subject for the name of an inn. I found a painting, too. I looked into that theory a little more. And there's a painting hanging in the Milwaukee Art Museum. It's called Scholar of Natural Sciences. And it's kind of a tongue-in-cheek painting by a Carl Spitzweg. He did this in 1875. And it's an apothecary. You can see it. I don't know how well you can see it there, but there's a crocodile hanging from the ceiling. And there's dinosaur bones. And in the corner, it's pretty faint, you can see a mummy. So the idea being that this poor apothecary, this guy huddled over his desk, the scholar of natural sciences, wants his clients to think that he has special things there that they can't get anywhere else, and that he has extraordinary knowledge of some kind. So I thought that sort of supported this theory that crocodile wasn't such an unusual subject after all. And besides, there's this rock in the basement that looks like a crocodile. Now I'm going to take you back for a little bit of history about the mill. The crocodile sign itself is an amazing artifact, but Jack, as an antiques dealer, I don't know how many of you knew him, but he was dealing in antiques here for a long time, 40, 50 years, and he was kind of one of the old style antiques dealers who really loved history and loved the artifacts, and the history to him was almost as important as the beauty or the value or the time put into the artifact. And he loved the idea that the DeWitt family was an important part of our history, and it wasn't just a piece of folk art. And so when I did the research on this about the home there and found out that Charles DeWitt lived there and that it was his son that opened the inn, that really just added to its value in Jack's eyes. The DeWitt's family had been a prominent family even in the Netherlands before they came here. It was Holland at that time, I guess. And Colonel Charles was a great-grandson of the original immigrant who came over in the 1600s and who settled, Cherick DeWitt settled on Hurley Avenue. And so his dad, Johannes, moved to that house that where the inn was, and that's where Colonel Charles grew up. And the amazing thing that you'll hear about is that how this DeWitt family home was a really center of community activity. They must have been just the most welcoming people in the world because it seemed like it was just an attraction for lots of activities. First, I'm just going to tell you a little bit about Charles DeWitt, and it would be really hard to underestimate his influence in the county. The list here is amazing. I'm going to have to read it to you because it's so long, but I'll go through it quickly. One of the things, I did a little extra research on him for this presentation just thinking there might be a little more interest than the usual audience in him. And one thing I found was great, a quote from the lieutenant governor at the time, who was a royalist governor. He was under royal authority. Cadwallader Calder referred to George Clinton and Charles DeWitt as fiery young radicals, and they didn't belong in the assembly as a result. So I thought that was quite a compliment, actually, to be called a fiery young radical. I mean, I can just see them form. I mean, today, if they lived today, they'd be doing Occupy America or something, you know, program. But here's just a list of his accomplishments. He led a regiment of Minutemen, that's his name, Colonel. He was in the Colonial Assembly. I'm not going to give you the years, it's just sort of a roughly chronological order. Colonial Assembly, he was in the Provincial Convention, the Provincial Congress. He voted to ratify the Declaration of Independence for New York. He was in the first convention of the state of New York. He was on the committee that framed the state constitution, so he helped write that. He was on the Council of Safety. He represented Ulster County in the Continental Congress, and he was several times in the state assembly, and he operated a mill, top of all this. And one of the committees he was on, I have to read you the name of this, it's great. It's the Committee for Detecting and Defeating Conspiracies Against the Liberties of America. That was the name of the committee. And I mean, today we call it Homeland Security, I suppose. And one of the functions of that committee was to make a decision on paroling the royalists after the revolution. They had jailed a lot of people, and now it was time to let them go or decide if they should be paroled. So one of the functions of the DeWitt House was to be a way station for these royalists that were being released from prison. And actually, it was Paul that pointed out that one of these British loyalists was the son of this Cadwallader Colden, who was junior, who actually had to come to Charles DeWitt's house, this fiery young radical's house, you know, to be released back into the community. So, okay. Following Charles, there were three other family members that became Ulster County's representatives in Congress, and eight representing the county in the state legislature. And his grandson, Charles, Colonel Charles, had a grandson, Charles, and that is the Charles DeWitt who started the Ulster Sentinel, which was a weekly paper started in 1826, I think it was. So the family did have and the interesting thing about the grandson, Charles, he revered his grandfather, didn't know him for very long, but just, you know, he knew how important his grandfather had been, and so he really tried to emulate his life after his grandfather's, and he ended up going, being an envoy to Guatemala, and then came back here to be a lawyer. But he has made a point that he wanted to be buried next to his grandfather Charles in the Hurley Cemetery. And the other thing about grandson, let's see. Oh, yes, and he had heard his father, Richard, tell stories about Garret. Garret was the one that had the inn. Garret was 14 years old when Kingston burned. And his father, Colonel Charles, took Garret into Kingston the day after it burned just to show him what had happened. And he told the story. I mean, that image of Kingston having burned stayed with him his whole life. So I suppose he told the story over and over. And that grandson, Charles, remembered what an impressive story that was. Okay. So Colonel Charles, very important guy. He was well-respected, well-liked, very productive, obviously. But also, they're very congenial people. The home ended up being a gathering place even before it was an inn. And of course, Colonel Charles was very well-connected, so and he had actually been superintendent at the Livingston estate, so he knew Chancellor Livingston and a cousin of his, Philip, the signer, Philip Livingston, would visit there. Governor Clinton did. He was very close to George Clinton. And John Jay was also a frequent visitor. In fact, there's a letter that exists from John Jay saying what pleasant hours he spent at the Charles DeWitt home. And just to support the idea of dancing in this house, there was one of my sources, I think it was the Schoonmaker History of Kingston, said that the kitchen was very large and big enough for quadrilles, and that's sort of like today's contra dance or square dance, so quadrilles in the kitchen. So it sounds like it was really a bustling place. Now, the mill itself was, as I said, built by Charles DeWitt, and its claim to fame is that it's fed by the Greenkill stream, and which I'll have to say there's some confusion about where the Greenkill comes from in the old documents. But the Greenkill is a spring-fed stream and flows through the coldest of winters. And so its claim to fame is that it could grind flour all winter and didn't have to stop. And so there was the really tough winter in Valley Forge was 1777 and 8. It was, I think, in February of 1778, Washington's troops were running out of food. And he made a plea to George Clinton, help me do something. And so George Clinton put his request to his good friend Charles DeWitt to, you know, produce flour, and they took flour and I think pork on wagons pulled by oxen down to Valley Forge from Ulster County. So one of the claims to fame for this mill is that it helped to save the troops at Valley Forge. The one sad thing I heard is that the oxen didn't come back from Valley Forge. I'm afraid they it's like, oh dear. And the other thing, I just want to read you the quote from Old Ulster Magazine, 1911. The ever-flowing stream that issued from the first Binnywater Lake to urge the millstones to never-ceasing labor when drought or shortage of crops stopped others was such a blessing to half-starving troops and perplexed providers that the Greenkill, DeWitt Mills, were known throughout the whole Patriot Army. So it was a very well-known place, the Greenkill Mills. Now, this says that it came from first Binnywater Lake. Well, if you look at a modern map, there's really no way that on the surface first Binnywater drains to the Greenkill. There is DeWitt Lake, but I mean, the ridge that's between the first Binnywater and the DeWitt Lake is our backyard. So, I mean, I know, unless there was an earthquake between then and now, that didn't happen, but there must have been. Although, interestingly, when they were doing hydrology studies for the Williams Lake project, they couldn't account for how much water was coming down the Greenkill. So what we think, maybe there's underground connections from first Binnywater into the Greenkill to account for that extra flow. So maybe they were smarter than we thought. What they meant was underground connection. An interesting letter from that mentions Mrs. Washington, Martha Washington, was a request for 10 to 12 barrels of flour, and this is January of 1783, this is a little later, preferred flour manufactured at Esopus, which would be Esopus meaning Kingston meaning here. And at that time, Washington was general of the Continental Army, but I looked up what a barrel was, that's 200 pounds of flour. That's a lot of flour. So I don't think, I mean, they were saying it was for her personal use, but I can't believe that. It must have been an order for the troops, not just for their personal use. But she was the one consulted to find out where should they get the flour, and she recommended getting it from Ulster County. Okay, so I was skeptical of this first Binnywater claim, so we checked this map. It's an 1858 map of Ulster County. And, this is going to be hard for you to see. Let's see if I can find myself. All right. I'm trying to find the. I can't walk around here. Okay, this has a grist mill. See GM there? And it says R. DeWitt, that's Richard DeWitt, and shows a grist mill there. And it does show a connection from these lakes over to first Binnywater. See, over this ridge? Well, that's not the way it is. I think they didn't want to go in there and look, so they just must have just drawn it. So, I don't know. The mill is on the present day anchor fence, Cobra Systems building. It's on the corner of 32 and DeWitt Mills Road. That old foundation can still be seen under that little building there. And interestingly, the accounts say that Route 32 went to the west side of the mill. And it's like, how's that? So what Michael Pavlov told me, Michael Pavlov owned the fence company at the time. He's since passed away. But when he was very interested in history, and he'd done a lot of reading about this area. So what he said, that he thinks the old Route 32 came curved along with that curved stone fence, sort of curved with that stone wall, and went to the other side of the mill. The new 32 just goes, cuts straight through. But apparently there was a curve in Route 32 at the time. And there was another story that was told that said the sluiceway for the mill went over the road. So if you it would be dripping, and if you went on the road, the water would be dripping from the sluiceway. So that, I haven't seen a map yet that really shows that clearly, though, that the road went to the other side of the mill. So it's a little bit of a mystery, but as I found, when you research history, you don't get all the answers that you want when you want them. All right. Now, at great personal risk, I climbed down this little rickety metal ladder that's next to the mill, out near the sign, full of poison ivy too, and just to get a picture of the falls that's still there that fed the mill. Shows a very vigorous green kill flowing over the dam. Yeah, I was glad to get out of there. Now this next picture is the second mill that was built on the site, and I was hoping to get a clue from this picture as to where the road would have been, and this is a very rough picture, but I kept it because it has the caption, and I think this is cut from the old Ulster magazine, "The old mill on the site of the older mill." So this is the mill that was built in 1850 to replace the 1750 mill, and then it lasted until, I forget what year it was taken down. So this is the foundation of that mill would be the same foundation that fence company is built on now. And this was taken from the side opposite Route 32, like the today's 32 would be on the other side of it. This next picture shows a little, where's the other picture? That's not in here either. Oh well, we can do without that one. There was a cleaner picture of that in another slide. So here is the millstone that you see in all the pictures of the house. I did some research on this, exchanged some emails with a Charles Hockensmith. He's an author of books about millstones, and Robert Grassi, who is a board member of the Society for the Preservation of Old Mills, Spoom, they call themselves, Spoom. And they confirmed that this millstone was definitely an Esopus millstone, or a Yankee millstone, which was carved from the Shawangunk Ridge. So it was a local millstone. They said it was a runner stone, which would have been the top stone. So it would have, when it was working, it would have been upside down from where it is now. It's at the end of its life because of its thickness. It would start out much thicker. And as they wear down, they might redress it. But this is towards the end of its life. It's dressed right now to grind feed or corn, something coarse. There'd be a different dressing on the stone, or cuts in it, for a fine flour. So I think it's nice to think this stone could have been the one that ground the flour that saved the troops. But maybe in a previous iteration of it, it might have ground flour, but its latest use was for something quite coarse, probably for animal feed. And they did confirm that, they said the lifespan is about 60 years for these. This could be an 18th century stone, I thought. So they didn't rule out that it could have been one that was being used during the Revolution. But it's tantalizing to think that it might be the one. They also said this is the only millstone built into a wall. There's plenty of millstones in walls around the country. Only one that's horizontal. They're always vertical in every other stone wall they've seen. And we don't know whether they might have used it as a stepping stone to get into carriages, or just maybe to, we're not sure why. All right. Okay, this shows the kind of a broken millstone in a natural environment. This was taken by Walter Levy of the Roundout Esopus Land Conservancy. He sent me this picture. It's taken above the Saunderskill in Accord. And that's an area where farmers would, on their off season, when they needed more income, would go up into the ridge and chip out a millstone for sale to give them extra income when they weren't working on their crops and their animals. And it turns out that a 10-mile stretch of the Shongunk Ridge between High Falls and Kerhonkson produced a lot of millstones. It was actually the biggest millstone producer in the America at the time. They still brought in French millstones, but for local production, it was a pretty big deal. And they would be loaded, so the farmer would ship out one of these stones, bring it down to the train station at Accord, put it on the O&W there, and it would go into Kingston. And there were a lot of stones shipped out of Kingston during the time that they were used. So that was sort of a nice little side story I learned about. And if you know Shongunk conglomerate, you'll recognize the stone. It's very hard and has these quartz inclusions. So it made very long-wearing stones. And apparently this one probably cracked as they were working it, so they just would abandon it if it was cracked while they tried to chip it out. I'm just saying that we are a major producer of American millstones. Kingston was the primary distribution point. We're talking about 1732 through mid-20th century. So it's quite late, actually. These experts that I consulted on millstones said there really is a lot of potential for researching the millstone industry here. It has not really been documented and archived as to where who did these cutting of the millstones and how many, and just, he said it's an area that's ripe for research. So if anybody out there wants to do millstone research, there you go. You could probably write a book. All right. Just a final connection to this, more to Hurley, but I guess Washington did come up to Kingston in this trip. 1782, General Washington took a trip from West Point to Kingston. On his way, he stopped in Hurley to thank the people for helping to supply the troops during the Revolution, and then he did go on to Kingston. This was sort of a Hurley-oriented presentation, so I wanted to make sure people knew about this. And this trip was it was just a few months after this trip that request for 10 to 12 barrels of flour came in. So anyway, he didn't get off his horse, I hear. He stopped on his horse and gave a little speech from his horse and then went on to Kingston. But it was important enough to Hurleyites that we wanted to remember that. So there's a historical marker there. Like not Washington slept here, but he stopped. His horse stopped here. So, I want to bring you back to the modern day and that phone call from Jack that started it all. So we have this piece of folk art coming up for auction just a few miles down the road. This was when Jay had his place in Rosendale. And we'd done our historical research. We're convinced of the provenance of this. Really wanted to keep this sign in Ulster County where it belonged. He said, I want to buy this thing. So Jack figured out what he was willing to bid for it. And he did this prior to the auction. He's not one to, in the heat of the moment, bid something up because he just had to have it. He decided ahead of time what he thought it was worth and what he thought he could sell it for and that sort of thing. So he's ready to bid. And Jack, if any of you know him, can bid toe-to-toe with anybody. He was a bold bidder. He could keep a straight face. He was really excellent at an auction. And in fact, he was so good and had rapport with the auctioneers that he could bid, and to look at him, you wouldn't know he was bidding. I mean, you really would, because if people knew that Jack Whistance was bidding on something, automatically the price went up. So he had ways of communicating his bids without being real obvious. He's great that way. But other bidders were there too. It wasn't just Jack. The Connecticut Historical Society was there, and they had authorization to spend a certain amount on this. They wanted it because it was a unique subject. It was in the original condition, all those things. And they have a collection, the nation's largest collection at numbering 60. So they had a lot. And there were, Jay had done a good job advertising, so there were several Americana dealers there, some on phone, some in person. And well, after some very lively bidding, Jack won the auction at, do you want to hear what the number was? with buyer's premium was $247,000. Right. And I think that's not even including tax, New York State tax. So, yes, so he owned it, and it was an amazing auction. I think I heard that Jay sent out for pizza for everybody, and it was, and I think some people didn't even realize quite what happened. It all just happened so quickly. It went from this to this, and think, wow, what happened? You know? So, that was in 2004 that happened. In 2005, the Art and Antiques magazine selected the Crocodile Inn as one of its 100 top treasures. Every year they have one issue that's top 100 treasures, and the crocodile sign was one of those. And later in 2007, when we were marketing the sign through Sotheby's, Leslie Kino, you know him, he's one of the Kino twins that you see on the Antiques Roadshow. He's the director of the Americana division at Sotheby's. He said it was iconic, you know, this piece of folk art. And he was very, very impressed by it. And when Jack owned the sign, he did hire a photographer to take a picture of it, which is why we still have this left. So his intent was not to buy it to keep it, but to resell it. And so he wanted to market it, so he wanted a good picture of it so he could show that to people. And I'm going to show you a couple pictures that were taken at that time because they show some interesting detail. Now, the sign that you the side you see here is the best side. It's not as weathered as the other. The reverse side, though, held a lot of fascination for Jack too, because it's the most weathered side. I mean, all tavern signs, there'll be one side that's more directly towards the prevailing weather, and would weather faster than the protected side. So this would be side facing the weather, and because of differential weathering, depending on what kind of paint or how much paint was put on it, you get this carving out by Mother Nature. Actually, Jack called it sculpting by Mother Nature, where you can see it's almost in relief, this outline of the crocodile, where the paint's gone, but you see sort of that in relief. And he liked that almost as well as the other side. And here's a detail of the hardware that was used, its original hardware. It's hand-wrought iron, and there are kind of horn-like hooks that were used to hang the sign, and they're held onto the sign with these straps with spade ends on them. Really lovely, simple hardware, but all handmade. So, unfortunately, soon after purchasing the sign, Jack really became quite ill and was unable to really personally see it through to selling it. So it ended up being marketed through Sotheby's, and they thought enough of it to include it in some pretty good company, I think, on the cover of their catalog for that sale. And I was very pleased that they actually printed my article verbatim as the description in their catalog. So I'm printed in Sotheby's catalog. I felt good about that. It also saved them the trouble, which was probably a windfall for them. But it made me feel good. But I think it looks quite at home with all these other quite valuable antiques. And as I said, the crocodile sign is obviously a wonderful piece of folk art, but it's also this window into history. And it's iconic, as Mr. Kino pointed out. And it kind of draws us into a world of 200 years ago and what it might have been like to come down the stagecoach route from Kingston and maybe settle in for the night or bring your grain into the mill to be ground. So even though Jack's wish was for the original sign to stay in Ulster County, he didn't get that wish. It ended up being sold at a private sale after the auction at Sotheby's. And so we don't even know where it went. You could waterboard me and I would not be able to tell you where the sign is now. What we do know is that it's owned by a private individual. So it's in a private collection in the Northeast somewhere. So one of these days it might come up for sale again, and one of you can bid on it if you like. But so I hope that when you come down Route 32 and see the historical signs there and the curving wall and that millstone in the wall, you'll remember this story and have a little better appreciation for what went on at that corner. And I would like you to feel free to come up and look, take a closer look at the sign, and I thank you for coming. I guess,
Gail, thank you so much. And do we have any questions for Gail?
Gail, I'm right here.
Come on.
Right here.
Okay.
You mentioned that your late husband, I assume.
Late father-in-law. This is my
husband. Father, I'm sorry.
Jack's my father.
Thanks for clearing that up. That he bought the sign for almost $250,000?
Yeah.
And do you know what it was sold for? Just by Sotheby's?
Yeah. Well, I'm not going to tell you, though. No, it was sold at a private sale through it didn't sell at auction. And so we sold it privately right after the auction. And, that not revealing details of that sale. Sorry. It was a good question, though.
Do we have any other questions?
What happened to the E after the D in the DeWitt?
Well, now that's a good question. He said, what happened to the E after the D? It must have been just a shorthand way. I mean, there were a lot of, like in Dutch, the de is like a preposition and the wit, of wit. So maybe that was considered something that could be abbreviated. But that's a guess on my part.
Maybe they had to pay by the letter when they made the sign.
Those are gilt letters. You can see the gilt still clinging to them.
You say it sold in a private sale after the auction. Yeah. How much did the auction, were the bids, what was the highest bid on it?
I'm not going to talk about that. So, I mean, I think Sotheby's might have some record of that you could find.
They didn't bid high enough no one bid high enough at the auction?
It didn't go for minimum, what we had set as a minimum.
Oh, okay.
At auction.
All right.
So while it probably is one of the questions that everybody has is what the price was that Sotheby's sold it, or the private sale was. And we'll probably get about 10 questions from every angle, but I think Gail is going to stick to her guns and she's not going to tell anyone. So we don't know what the price is, and I don't know that we're going to.
All right.
Any other questions?
You say that the mill was from the green kill, which would be the stream that came through that possibly came from the first Bennywater, but that's kind of iffy. So that is not, does have anything to do at all with the DeWitt Lake? The water that comes through
DeWitt,
to the mill, is it fed from
DeWitt
the DeWitt Lake?
It drains from DeWitt Lake.
Okay, yeah. So that is a part of DeWitt Lake.
Yeah, it runs, and then the stream, there's upstream from DeWitt Lake, there's a smaller lake, I'm not even sure if it has a name.
Okay.
But these are all,
DeWitt
Lake and the smaller lake are all on this side of a ridge between that and First Bennywater. Mm-hmm. So I just don't see how the topography could have changed that much, where it would actually be draining. But like these hydrologists said, that there must be some underground connections, and it's well known that there's a karst topography with limestone cavities, and so it's not hard to believe that there could be an underground stream.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Anyone else? Any other questions?
Come on, Chester. Don't you have a question?
That stream that comes down into DeWitt Lake comes out of a very small pond.
Yeah, there's a very smaller body of water ahead, upstream from it.
And there's been a lot of discussion of which lake it comes from.
And
no
what?
One's, I've never heard of anything.
I don't know why these maps would have had this direct connection. It's just odd. Yeah.
It is, and it was constantly commented. And one of the reasons that, as Gail said, that the DeWitt Mill was so important was first the quality of the flour that it put out, but also it's very difficult to stress how important it was. To have that water that ran all year round.
Because
it did not freeze.
Deep spring fed.
So we don't know, I guess we don't know exactly where it came from, but it was very strong. It kept that going for that entire time, and that was the problem. Yeah. Sometimes these streams would freeze, the mill would not work, and you've got a problem, particularly during the Revolutionary War. The DeWitt Mill continued to go. It was always known that it would go all year round, and you could always, always rely on it. And that was very, very important.
I think we should all be really proud of having a facility like that here. And since I did this presentation, I did a history of farming exhibit for the Early Heritage Society, and in doing that, it reinforced the idea that Ulster County was considered the breadbasket of the colonies of the Revolution. Up until about 1850, the main crop was wheat, a lot of it exported, and until the Erie Canal went through and the blight hit the wheat, and Hessian fly came in, and then more competition from the west through the Erie Canal. But until then, until about 1850, wheat was a big crop, and it was, you know, we really fed a lot of the colonies.
Yeah, and George and Charles DeWitt, again, as Gail referred to, he was such an incredible figure in our local history, not only in our local history, but in New York and in the United States. Again, he's a member of the Continental Congress. He's a member of the Provincial Congress. He's a member of the Constitutional Convention that meets in the Ulster County Courthouse to form the state of New York. The first thing that they do there is they have to write a constitution. Well, a committee had been appointed to write the New York State Constitution. The main figures on that were John Jay, Gouverneur Morris, and Robert Livingston. Charles DeWitt was on that committee to write the New York State Constitution. In fact, he's the only Ulster County member, the only person from Ulster County who was on that. So he was seen as an equal with those men. In fact, John Jay was the leader of the Committee of Detecting Conspiracies, and that's why his relationship and the trust that they had was why important loyalists that they were going to parole. First of all, the fact that they're going to parole them at all shows something. They always start, the important, the prominent figures, the Tories and the loyalists, went to Charles DeWitt. Colden went there. Probably the most notorious Tory and loyalist in our area was a man named Roloff Elting. He also was paroled to Charles DeWitt. So he keeps coming up, and he was really a very, very important figure. And this sign does tie back to him. The DeWitt Mill and the tavern that came there was really the meeting place of the community. It was where you went not only to have your grain ground, but to find out the news of the day, to get the opinion of the most important people in the community who were at that time the DeWitts. So an incredibly important family, an incredibly important individual, and this sign is really a tangible piece of history that we can touch and connect with that family. And they have been, you know, there are still DeWitts, and there are still prominent DeWitts around today, but they do not get the credit that they deserve, these individuals. And Gail deserves so much credit for continuing this. She, more than anyone else, is responsible for keeping this story alive and reintroducing us to one of the most important figures in our history, Charles DeWitt.
And actually, if there's any DeWitt descendants here who might have pictures or stories to tell or want more information, I'd love to talk to you. So.
And one thing that does make the story of the sign incredibly interesting is the sign was originally found in a dumpster.
Well, it was in the room. I think it was in the house, but in a pile of what was going to be thrown out. So it was saved. So it's really
It is a rags to riches story. It's a buried treasure, and it really, but it's such an important thing. It's a wonderful story, and it's a wonderful reflection on our community. And we thank Jack for doing this, trying to keep it here.
It's a miracle that it survived, because the house burned like a few years after it was removed. It was thrown away in a sense, saved for many years, and then sort of thrown in a pile. Somebody recognized it as something to save. Jay recognized it as something he wanted to sell. You know, and Jack, you know, tried to keep it here and didn't. So it, at any point in time, it could have really been lost again to our own knowledge of it. So.
We talk often about some of the buildings that we've lost that are really such important parts of our history. Look at a sign. What are the chances of a sign, a wooden sign, that's out exposed to the elements, coming down to us today. It is a shame that it isn't here. Hopefully at some point it will return. So everybody save your money. It may pop up, keep your eyes out, because we would really hope that you'd bring it here and you'll bring it up. But again, we would ask everybody, it's a laser scan of the sign in incredible detail. You really have to see it up close to see how special it is. But we'd ask you all prior to leaving tonight, come on up and take a look. And again, Gail, thank you so much.
Thank you.
And I have to apologize because some of these slides were are hidden in here, and I
oh, you said something about
hidden. Yeah, they shouldn't be anymore, but well, I apologize, because if you're not aware of where this sign, this was, and you probably drive by it, you've driven by it a million times. It's at, if you're on 32 going north or south, if you're going south from Kingston towards Rosendale, it's one of the, you go down at the bottom of the hill, and on the side is a Cobra fence building, and there's a red house kind of up in the side, and there's a stone wall in front of it. The blue historic marker is by, is at the southern end of the Cobra fence building, and you would probably miss it if you weren't paying attention, but that's where, on the southern end of DeWitt Mills Road, is where the mill was, and on the northern end was where the house and the tavern is. So if you drive by, take a look. It really, it, I would say it's northern Rosendale, town of Ulster, southern Kingston. But it is. It's, you know, it's a great way for us, you know, when you can touch these things, when you can touch something that has been a part of history, it makes it so much more special. This sign is part of that. So Gail, thank you for talking to us about it, for keeping the DeWitt family's history alive, and we really appreciate you being here. It's a wonderful presentation. I do want to tell people about, again, our upcoming events. Next month, July 17th, we have the Courts of Kingston, Providing the Building Blocks of a Nation. Hayes Clement is going to be giving that presentation. The brick industry was one of the monolithic industries in Kingston. It really was one of those industries that made Round Out and Kingston one of the most important places, certainly in New York State and really in the nation. And the Courts were a family that began in the brick industry. They, their company ultimately became Hutton Bricks, I believe. But they built a mansion, the Courts Mansion, down off Delaware Avenue. And if you haven't seen it, you really have to go take a look at it. It is absolutely beautiful. But Hayes is gonna tell us about that. And then in August, we're gonna talk about Robert Dietz, somebody who really should have been a subject of this series some time ago. Robert Dietz won the Medal of Honor in World War II, an incredible story. What he did is believed to have shortened the duration of World War II. And you think about the number of lives that were saved by his acts. He's buried in Wiltwyck Cemetery today. So you can actually go to Wiltwyck Cemetery and see his grave. On it has an engraving of the Medal of Honor, and actually a portion of President Harry Truman's speech that he gave when he awarded the Medal of Honor. So Daniel Joyce, who has been working diligently and tirelessly to have the post office on Cornell Street named after Robert Dietz, and I believe that that is in the process of being done through New York State. So he's gonna tell us all about Robert Dietz. So we hope that you can join us for those two. In fact, this Sunday, it's Father's Day. We want to wish all of our fathers a happy Father's Day. And if anybody is interested, at 2:00 at Wiltwyck Cemetery, where Robert Dietz is buried, Friends of Historic Kingston will be having a cemetery tour. I will be giving that. So if you are around, come on down. And we do want to always take the opportunity to thank all the people who make this possible. All the Bob Rizzo, who records all these. If anybody wants a copy of this talk or any of the talks we've done this for more than 3 years. Bob has them and he can get them for you. All the people that publicize this event, Hugh Reynolds always does a great story in Kingston Times. Joe Tantillo does all the flyers and the PowerPoints, all the people that are involved, Ed Ford. So there are so many people that make this possible. Again, we stopped adding names because we couldn't anymore, but one thing we do want to do is make sure that you understand how much we appreciate you being here. If it wasn't for you, we wouldn't do this. Your love of our local history, your support of the series has made this really a labor of love. So we thank you. Gail, we thank you very much, and we hope to see everybody next month. So happy Father's Day, and have a good weekend.